हेलो सेकेंड स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू द ऑनलाइन क्लास। टुडे वी विल गेट टू नो अबाउट फ्रांसिस बेकन, हुज एसे ऑफ फ्रेंडशिप इज प्रिस्क्राइब्ड इन योर सिलेबस ऑफ पेपर फर्स्ट प्रोज एंड फिक्शन। वी विल स्टार्ट विद इंट्रोडक्शन एंड बैकग्राउंड टू द ऑथर। विल नो अबाउट हिज फेमस वर्क्स, हिज स्टाइल ऑफ राइटिंग, एंड देन विल ऑल्सो ब्रीफली डिस्कस हिज एसे of friendship. So let us start with a little bit of biographical details about Bacon. He was born in London in 1561 into a prominent wealthy family. His father held a powerful government position of Lord Keeper of the Seal. His education also reflects his upper class background. He went to Cambridge, studied law. He was a good lawyer and he was appointed as a Queen's Counsel in 1598. When King James I came to the throne, his fortunes rose still higher until he became Lord High Chancellor in 1618, the highest judicial post in the country. He was knighted and created Viscount St. Albans. And when he was at peak of his career, he suddenly tumbled down. He was charged with bribery, which he confessed. He got jailed for a brief period of time and also removed from his post at public office. After his forced retirement, he died of pneumonia while he was doing some scientific experiment with the ice. Being a true Renaissance man, Bacon has contributed a lot to the literature, and some of his chief works I have listed here. First is Various Essays, which was published in 1597, and this work got expanded into later editions. This included essays with titles like Of Studies, Of Discourse, Of Truth, and so on and so forth. And they are discussions on general topics and fully objective, impersonal. And he described his essays as dispersed meditations. Then came Advancement of Learning in 1605, and this is a philosophical work. Then there is Novum Organum in 1620, yet another philosophical work by him in Latin language, and New Atlantis in 1626, that is an unfinished piece of work, also in Latin by him, and it got published after his death. In his works, Bacon attempted to reform or restore the process of knowledge with a scientific approach, as it was the age of Renaissance, an age of revival or learning and knowledge, which existed in the past, and Bacon emerged as one of the champions of the age. And Bacon had a great influence of Renaissance humanism on his thought. He dreamed of a world where scientific progress can remove the sufferings of human race. He is also known as the father of empiricism. Now, what does this term mean? Empiricism is a belief that people should rely on practical experiences and experiments rather than on theories as basis for knowledge, and Bacon followed this matter in his works, and that's why he is credited for developing the scientific method in the world of literature. And there is famous quote by Alexander Pope, a great Augustan age poet, in which he refers to him as the wisest, brightest, and the meanest of mankind. And when you read his works, this statement proves to be true about him. Now, let us discuss his style of writing. So, the first prominent feature of his style is aphorism, also known as epigrammatic style of writing. So, aphorism means a short sentence expressing a truth in the fewest possible words, and the sentence has the quality of a maxim or a proverb. We can quote his sentences in our day-to-day lives, and there is terseness of expression and brevity, which is very captivating and enchanting for readers. I've quoted a sentence from one of his essays titled as Of Studies, where he says, "Studies serve for delight, for ornament, and for ability." Now, this sentence appears to be very condensed and concise, but the thought it carries is quite deep. It represents that studies serve for three purposes. It is an activity which brings joy and happiness. It gives us delight. And second, as an ornament, it is used for affectation, to show off. It adds a charm to a personality. And third, some people study to gain some ability, to implement what they have learned, to gain wisdom from study. Now, sentences like this are called aphoristic, a short sentence that is pregnant with deep thought. I mean, they have the quality of being expanded into a long passage, and Bacon's essays are filled with such type of aphoristic sentences. Secondly, Bacon is a great rhetorician, meaning he has a remarkable quality of expression, which attracts his readers. His practical and worldly wisdom appeals to the imagination of the readers, and his essays are the finest example of his rhetoric ability. For example, in his essay, Of Revenge, he states, "A man that studieth revenge keeps his own wounds green." Again, a very impressive statement that forces us to think over. Another notable feature of his style is the use of imagery and analogy. Analogy is a comparison between two things that shows a way in which they are similar, and sometimes similes and metaphors are also used to create an analogy. And Bacon uses metaphors, images, similes, and analogies in his essays. He draws imagery from nature and everyday life, while his analogies are from classical mythology, Bible, astronomy, and philosophy. His essay, Of Friendship, that we are going to study in our next lecture, abounds in examples from Roman classical history. And in the same essay, at one point, he differentiates between a crowd and company, where he says, I quote, "For a crowd is not company, and faces are but a gallery of pictures, and talk but a tinkling cymbal where there is no love," unquote. Next is impersonal and objective writing, and this is another characteristic of his style. And his essays are never written in conversational or chatty style. They are objective and logical, written from a detached point of view on general topics. He does not provide his personal opinion, and even if there is a need to prove his statements or to give examples for his arguments, he takes examples from history, which does not require his personal opinion. Next, there is plenty much use of allusions and quotations. Allusion is a brief and indirect reference to a person, place, or a thing within a text, and Bacon's essay abound in Latin quotations and references to classical literature and history, and also from Bible, as he was a well-read man, a scholar. It was very easy for him to quote from different sources, but sometimes it becomes very difficult for an average reader to understand his Latin phrases or references from classical literature, because it will require some beforehand knowledge and also slow reading of his essays. For example, he quotes a Latin proverb in the essay of friendship, which says, I quote, "Magna civitas, magna solitudo," unquote, meaning, in great cities, there is greater solitude, greater loneliness, because men feel lonely in a big city, which is very true. In addition to these, sometimes Bacon adds a poetic charm to his lines, but it is occasional. It never happens too much, but it is there sometimes. So these were some chief traits of his style, and we can say his style suited for all occasions, and for that matter, he is commonly known as the father of English prose and essays, and he has no match if we think in context of style, presentation, and linguistic devices. Now, let us have a brief overview of his essay of friendship that we will be studying in detail in coming lectures. So, this essay of friendship was written on the request of his friend Toby Matthew, and the essay is a celebration of their friendship, which stood firm in good and bad times. It was first published in 1597 in his collection of essays. He opens the essay with Aristotle's view on companionship, in which he stated that man is a social being and he prefers to be in society, and if a man avoids society, there is two possibilities. First, either he is an animal, or second, he is a god. But Bacon does not fully agree with Aristotle's views, and he goes on to argue his case. Then he elaborates upon the three principal fruits of friendship. First is medicinal or curative benefits of having a friend. Second is friendship provides comfort and stability through hard times. And Bacon compares the third fruit of friendship to a pomegranate, a fruit, by which he means friends helping people in many different areas of life. And a good part of the essay is dedicated to the allusions and references from classical Roman history. As I've already told you that Bacon is very fond of quoting from classical history, and he gives examples of ancient Roman people like Julius Caesar, Brutus, Augustus, Pompey, and many more. By giving these examples, Bacon points out the various aspects of friendship, its benefits, its risks, and its hazards. And he concludes his essay by criticizing a person who finds it hard to live in a society as according to Bacon, an unsociable person is unfit to live in the society. So students, we have come to the end of our today's session. In the next lecture, we will take up with the text of the essay of Friendship. We'll do a detailed and thorough line by line explanation of the text. I've already shared with you the text and annotation. Please go through it, as it will help you in understanding in a better way. Hope to see you in our next video lecture. Thank you.